was established one sunny afternoon in 1386 when a gang of people went for a walk to a place called Canterbury!
Profoundest pit I dare to- tongue would kill a fly. And nothing grieves me heartily indeed. But as I cannot do 10,000 more!
The rest is silent.
Ah!
dull from sluggish ease, and learns a clown the arse to please, humbles the babe, kindles the coals, makes miser's frames cowards' bolts. Tis he reforms the sots from drink,
probable at that.
turned into a hit man's song in assemblies!
Jerusalem! And Jesus be!
gave up.
Mary had a dream about a man stitching bits of corpses together, a lost, misbegotten amalgamation of the dead with a living soul that sought for love and was rejected by its creator.
It was on a dreary night of November that I beheld the accomplishment of my toils with an anxiety that almost amounted to agony. Collected the instruments of life around me that I might infuse a spark of being into the lifeless thing that lay at my feet. It was already 1 in the morning. The rain pattered dismally against the panes, and my candle was nearly burnt out when, by the glimmer of the half extinguished light, I saw the dull yellow eye of the creature open. It breathed hard, and a convulsive motion agitated its lips. How can I describe my emotion at this catastrophe?
It wasn't a bad story for a 19-year-old. It was called Frankenstein.
That feels like really Wordsworth. I wandered lonely as a tower that floats on high of vales and hills, when all at once I saw a crowd, a host of golden daffodils beside the lake beneath the trees fluttering and dancing in the breeze. Continuous as the stars that shine and twinkle on the Milky Way, they stretched in never-ending line along the margin of a bay. 10,000 saw I at a glance, tossing their heads in sprightly dance.
Interrupted by
a nutshell. It's about a governess called Jane Eyre who gets a job in a mansion teaching a child and who falls in love with the mysterious Mr. Rochester. It's Gilbert and Ona, who keeps his mad wife locked away in an attic.
Charlotte Bronte.
Jane Eyre. In the deep shade at the farther end of the room, a finger ran backwards and forwards. What it was, whether beast or human being, one could not at first sight tell. It grovelled seemingly on all fours. It snatched and growled like some strange wild animal. But it was covered with clothing and a quantity of dark, grizzled hair, wild as a mane, hid its head and face. The third sister, Anne, was the youngest of the Bronte sisters, and our search was more of a rebel. She was a feminist before the word was invented. Her novel, The Tenant of Glasgow Hall, is considered the first feminist novel. It deals with, amongst other subjects, alcoholism, infidelity, and above all, the iniquity of the then existing law that stated women had no rights whatever, and that once married, they and all they owned was the property of men.
Anne Bronte, the tenant of Wildfell Hall.
I am satisfied that if a book is a good one, it is so whatever the sex of the author may be. All novels are or should be written for both men and women to read, and I am at a loss to conceive how a man should commit himself to write anything that would be really disgraceful to a woman, or why a woman should be censured for writing anything that would be proper and becoming for a man.
Her novel was published in 1849, when she was 19 years old. Same age Mary Shelley was when she wrote Frankenstein. Other Victorians came. And then they went, leaving behind Lord Tennyson's imperialistic farce about a gang of bloodthirsty idiots who were charging off in the wrong direction and got clobbered!
Charge of the Light Brigade. of a modern age was Dante Gabriel Rossetti, who solemnly buried his unpublished poems in the grave of his first wife, Lizzie Siddle, the great pre-Raphaelite beauty. Later, he attacked the forts and dug the bones up again.
Age as D.H. Lawrence, but could have been
some corner of a foreign field that is forever England. There shall be in that rich earth a richer dust concealed. A dust whom England bore, shaped, made aware, gave once her flowers to love, her ways to roam, a body of England's, breathing English air, washed by the rivers, blessed by the suns of home. And think, this heart, all evil shed away, a pulse in the eternal mind, no less, gives somewhere back the thoughts by England given, her sights and sounds, dreams happy as her day, and laughter, lads of friends, and gentlemen, in hearts at peace, under an English.
White eyes writhing in his face.
My friends! You would not tell with such high zest to children ardent for some desperate glory the old lie!
Dulce et decorum est pro patria mori.
His are probably the greatest war poems in English literature. Certainly no other 20th century poet had written so clearly about the pity and futility of the war. He was killed in action less than a week before the war ended. He was 25 years old. He was one of a whole generation of boys and young men who were wiped from the face of the earth. In a conflict, few of them really understood.
Dylan Thomas. Milligan, a manic depressive who struggled with mental illness for years. Spike wrote seriously bad, serious poems and brilliantly good nonsense poems as he swung back and forth between mental darkness and bubbling enthusiasm.
On his gravestone, he had inscribed, Dirt me lat gerev me brocha, which, when translated into English from Gaelic, reads,
I told you I was ill.
Around this time was a remarkable poet, older than Spike Milligan, called Stevie Smith. Brian Patten, Blake's purest daughter. Must she always walk with death? Must she? I went out and asked the sky.
No. It said no. She'll do as I do. As I do. I go on forever.
Who, like Spike, fits into no categories?
Must she always walk with death? Must she? I went and asked the soil.
No, said no. She'll do as I do. I will polish her forever.
She was tiny, sharp-witted, and she dressed in clothes that could have fitted the child.
Must she always walk with death? Must she? I listened to the water.
No, it said no. She'll do as I do. I will cleanse her forever.
She half read, half chanted her poems.
Must she always walk with death? Must she?
No, said the fire. She'll burn as I burn, as I burn. She will be in brilliance forever.
And was poo-pooed by the literary establishment of the time.
Oh, but I am not death, said death slyly. I am only no longer living. Only no longer knowing exorbitant grief. Do not fear me. So many share me.
Writing in the Times History Supplement was a famous poet critic called What's-His-Name, who dismissed her poems as trivial.
Stevie Elemental, free now of the personal, through sky and soil, and fire and water. Swim on, Blake's purest daughter.
Stevie wrote the immortal lines.
I was much too far out all my life. And not waving, but drowned.
Lines that have now entered the English language, but no one can remember a word of what What's-His-Name wrote.
The poet Laurie Lee was writing it around the same time as Stevie Smith.
aimed low in life,